Thank you, colleagues. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 792 in the name of Stuart McMillan on National Eye Health Week 2021. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put. And would those members who wish to speak in the debate please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Stuart McMillan to open the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr McMillan.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, first of all, I'm delighted to have secured this important members' debate, and I want to thank the many MSPs across the chamber who have signed the motion. Also want to thank all those organisations who have provided briefings for the debate at RNIB Scotland, Sight Scotland, Optometry Scotland and also the RPP Group. As convener of the cross-party group on visual impairment, I every year try to highlight the importance of National Eye Health Week to raise awareness of the importance of looking after our eye health. But I don't just do it in 1 week a year. I do talk to constituents and do raise the issue throughout the year also. Since 2006, people in Scotland have been able to attend a free eye health check every 2 years, and it's vital that we all make use of this service, even if we think our eyesight is fine. That's because eye examinations not only help detect changes to the eyes before they affect vision, but they can pick up on other health conditions such as high blood pressure, raised cholesterol, diabetes and increased risk of stroke. Therefore, going for your free eye examination every 2 years isn't just important for your eye health, but it's also important for your overall health. COVID-19 has made us all pay more attention to our physical and mental health, but worryingly, there were 4.3 million fewer eye appointments during the pandemic. That very much is understandable, but concerning at the same time. And COVID-19 has also resulted in increased waiting times for appointments, with many postponed, understandably, once again, due to the lockdown. Now, the longer patients wait to receive treatment, the more serious their eye condition is likely to become, which can also result in further deterioration of vision. Now, vital eye care has, however, been available throughout the pandemic at emergency eye care treatment centres and also through virtual appointments. Now, once restrictions were eased, optometrists offered routine eye health checks with measures in place to minimise the risk of spreading COVID-19. And at present, there are around 178,000 people in Scotland with sight loss, including almost 3,000 people in my constituency. Saying also that national figure is expected to double over the next 20 years. The most common cause of sight loss is age-related macular degeneration, but people of all ages can experience sight loss, and with the most common cause amongst working-age people being diabetic retinopathy. According to the RPP group, in Scotland, glaucoma affects approximately 10% of those over the age of 75, or around 47,000 Scots, and only becomes more common and severe with increasing age. And glaucoma is also responsible for approximately 10% of UK blindness registrations. And so, considering that 50% of sight loss is avoidable, I cannot stress enough the importance of using the free eye examinations. I did this again this summer, and the experience was excellent once again. My message to Scotland is very, very simple. Now that the restrictions have eased greatly and optometrists are open for business, please pay that visit. Another way we can reduce our chance of developing sight loss and improving our overall health too is to quit smoking. I've never smoked, but I know that people who have both successfully quit, as well as others who have struggled to quit. Research shows that smokers are twice as likely to become visually impaired compared to non-smokers, as the chemicals in the cigarettes can affect the lenses and blood vessels in the eyes. Now, wearing sunglasses is also important to protecting your vision. And while sometimes we may have a joke about the Scottish weather and Scottish summer, it doesn't need to be scorchingly hot and sunny for ultraviolet light to harm your cornea, retina and lenses. Eating a well-balanced diet is also important, as a diet rich in vitamins can preserve your eye health for longer. I'm saying also, National Eye Health Week is also about recognising the issues facing people already living with sight loss. And for them, the last 18 months has been additionally challenging. Sight Scotland asked over 400 people for their views on how they were impacted by coronavirus restrictions. And the main findings show that 70% said their sight loss had made lockdown an even harder experience. And 43% said they were still not confident about going back into society with social distancing requirements in place. How we emerge from the pandemic and what our recovery looks like has to be mindful of people living with sight loss. Additional outdoor seating and reconfiguration of public spaces and pavements is, of course, welcome, but we have to consider how this affects visually impaired people. These adaptations should seek to improve accessibility for everyone. They should not make navigating pavements, paths or parks more difficult for people who are visually impaired. Now, this is an issue that has come up in the cross-party group visual impairment in the past, which Mr. Briggs is very much aware of. It's also important that we improve support and services available to people living with sight loss, as the latest research carried out once again by Sight Scotland showed that 55% of participants said they hadn't enough information about where they could find support after their diagnosis. And 83% said it was important to provide more support for family members and carers. In addition to that, 58% said they had not been made aware of financial support available to them. And I therefore welcome that Sight Scotland's new national support line, launched today by the Minister for visually impaired people, to access advice and talk through concerns. That number is 0800 024 8973. The Sight Scotland support line is part of Sight Scotland's new family wellbeing service, which aims to reach everyone living with sight loss across Scotland. It's free and open 9 in the morning to 5 p.m, Monday to Friday, and a person can get in touch by telephone, email or by requesting a call back from an advisor. Also, RNIB Scotland offer advice and support by phoning their helpline on 030 123 9999. And you can even ask Alexa to call their helpline without needing to touch your phone. They also have various other services and resources to help rebuild any lost confidence. I'm sorry that I can't attend the Optometrist Scotland webinar tomorrow, entitled Future of Community Eye Care in Scotland, as I will be attending a funeral of a former MSP, Bruce McPhee. But I do encourage MSPs and their staff to log on and engage in that. I know that Optometrist Scotland work very well with the Scottish Government and encourage that engagement to continue. Presiding Officer, just to conclude, sight is the sense that most people say they fear losing the most. And taking care of your vision is a key, is that very much key to prevention. So with that, I want to thank everyone once again for signing the motion so we can have the debate, and certainly look forward to other contributions from colleagues. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. McMillan. And I now call Emma Harper up to 4 minutes, please, Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I welcome the opportunity to speak in the National Eye Health Week debate and congratulate my colleague Stuart McMillan on securing it. Eyesight is one of the most important senses. 80% of what we perceive comes through our sense of sight. This week, the National Eye Health Week has been established to communicate the importance of good eye health, and it rightly encourages people from every walk of life to take better care of their eyes and have regular sight tests. There are 5 key areas to protecting and promoting good eye health, and Stuart McMillan has covered in more detail than perhaps I will in my time. But it is worth reiterating that healthy diet is really important, because studies show that what we eat can affect our vision. Antioxidants can help prevent retinal damage, and one antioxidant which is hugely beneficial is lutein. Exercise is important. Lack of exercise contributes significantly to several eye conditions, particularly amongst people aged over 60 and over. Reduced alcohol is an interesting one, because excessive alcohol consumption can lead to serious health conditions which can have a detrimental effect on eye health. And stopping smoking after ageing, smoking is the biggest factor for developing macular degeneration. My younger sister, Buffy, is an ophthalmic nurse specialist, presiding officer, and she specialises in glaucoma care, and she keeps me and her patients right with her expert knowledge. And it'll be interesting to hear from her later on what she thinks of the debate, because I know she's watching tonight. Optometrists play a crucial role in our community, and however, as with all health professions, they have been particularly hard hit by the pandemic. Over the course of the pandemic, I engaged with Optometry Scotland and the negative impact that the pandemic has had on optometry, with 8 months of no face-to-face appointments. But Sight Scotland have carried out research where they spoke to people with visual impairment and those close to them in Scotland since lockdown. and I thank Site Scotland for their briefing ahead of this debate. The report highlighted that 70% of people said their sight loss has made lockdown a worse experience. 50% would not be confident about offering support to someone with visual impairment, and a large number of people were unable to attend their optometrist and therefore attended hospital instead. So I want to recognise the impact COVID has had on optometry services and encourage the Scottish Government to ensure that they are supported in the upcoming budget. We've heard that potentially that the optometrists are looking for a 3% fee increase, which has been required or requested by Optometry Scotland. Presiding Officer, in 2016-17 alone, Community Eye Care in Scotland saved the NHS £71 million through carrying out 1.8 million primary care or primary eye examinations. And importantly, the Community Optometry Services in 2016-17 stopped over 370,000 people from attending hospital for eye issues. In 2019, I went along to see for myself the very positive impact community optometry can have when I visited Stranraer Specsavers, where I met with Chair of Optometry Scotland, Dave Quigley, prescribing optometrist Elaine Hawthorne, and the communications officer, Ross Stevens. And during the visit, I was able to hear directly about how, as well as identifying any specific issues with sight, that an eye check, which is free in Scotland, can help identify conditions such as diabetes, high blood pressure, arthritis, and even signs of dementia. I was able to hear about the benefits of having a 3D eye scan done, which can allow the optometrist to have a greater picture of the eye and therefore be able to pick up any developing issues early, preventing late diagnosis and the need for secondary acute care. I would therefore, one interesting thing that was highlighted is that the optometrists are not recognised as allied health professionals, but they're saying that that would help them be better at working in partnership with the National Health Service. So there's one thing I would ask the Minister to consider is that whether allied health professionals would be added to the list as optometry personnel be part of that. So thank you, Presiding Officer. I realise the time is on. So in closing, I want to again welcome the debate and thank Optometry Scotland for all they do and encourage everyone to regularly have their sight checked.
Thank you, Ms Harper. And I now call on Miles Briggs. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Briggs.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I start also by thanking Stuart McMillan for bringing forward this important members' debate this evening, but more importantly for all the work that he does actually in this Parliament campaigning on eye health issues. I think it's really important we recognise that as well. National Eye Health Week is an excellent opportunity to highlight the importance of good eye health. And can I start also by paying tribute to Sight Scotland and RNIB, as members already have, for their useful briefings ahead of this evening's debate. Both charities do exceptional work supporting blind and partially sighted people across Scotland. And in the Edinburgh Evening News today, I noted Edinburgh OAP Charlie Burns, who's 83, and his daughter Gail Burns praised Sight Scotland for their new national support line. Charlie's been diagnosed with macular degeneration, the most common cause of sight loss. But Gail got in touch with Sight Scotland to ask for what support would be available to both Charlie and herself, and said that it's made a huge difference to have that support at an early stage for her dad's after her dad's diagnosis. And the experience of Charlie and Gail reinforces recent findings by Sight Scotland, where 83% of participants said it was important to provide more support to family members and carers, and 87% said support with the emotional impact of sight loss was so important. And we are facing huge challenges in preventing sight loss across Scotland. There's currently 178,000 people in Scotland who do have sight loss, with this number expected to double over the next 20 years. The pandemic has clearly had a negative impact on eye health, with fewer eye checks being carried out, but that's over the last year and a half. In my own region, for example, in Edinburgh, Lothian patients are experiencing extremely long waits for ophthalmology services, and all this combined really does present a number of concerns, which I hope this debate can really bring to ministers' attention. Now, I noticed also ahead of this debate that there'd been a significant call to ministers by the sector to look at a proper long-term funding settlement. Optometry Scotland had asked for a minimum budget increase of 3% annually in real terms. on fees, and for the Scottish Government to also agree an annual process around reviewing and negotiating eye care examination fees. I hope that's something the Minister can maybe touch upon when she's closing the debate on how we can make sure that services do recover post-pandemic, and we make sure that as many people as possible are going to be able to access eye health services across Scotland. On a separate note, at the end of the last session, SNP ministers had announced that they were also withdrawing funding for a replacement Princess Alexandra Eye Pavilion. Now, throughout the past year, I, along with other colleagues, and I see Sarah Boyack in the chamber still as well, have campaigned to make sure that we did see a U-turn on that from ministers. But it's also an important opportunity, I think, tonight to highlight the need of Edinburgh and the Lothians for information to be brought forward on when we will see that long-term new hospital replacement brought forward. And so I'd also appreciate whether or not ministers could outline a timetable and timescale for that replacement hospital, and whether or not ministers have also looked at the need specifically for maintenance for the old eye pavilion here in the capital, which is no longer fit for purpose and which already is demonstrating significant challenges, including old lifts, which are often out of use. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, because I know time is tight, can I put on my record, like others have already, a huge thank to opticians across Scotland and healthcare professionals who continue to provide eye health checks during the pandemic. And most importantly, can I fully support the call by Stuart McMillan and Optometry Scotland and RNIB Scotland to encourage people who have not had an examination over the last 2 years to now return to practices to get their eye health checked. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Mr. Briggs. And I call Sarah Boyack, who will be followed by our last speaker, Colin Smith. Sarah Boyack, up to 4 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I also want to start by congratulating Stuart McMillan for the work he does and for securing this excellent debate tonight, and for the praise he's rightly given to RNIB Scotland, Optometry Scotland, and I also want to thank Sight Scotland for the fantastic work they're doing across the country. I'm very keen to support eye health for my constituents in the Lothians, whether it's at the very local level, whether it's getting access to emergency services, because over the last year, as Miles Briggs have said, it's really been brought to the forefront by firstly the cancellation of the new eye pavilion and then the very welcome U-turn of a commitment that we will get the eye pavilion. But it is, as Miles Briggs has said, it's 5 years off, even though there's a huge amount of work that's been done for it by the NHS Lothian. I think Stuart McMillan's motion rightly highlights how vital it is for people to book their eye check every 2 years. It's free, and I think the impact the pandemic has had has made many people not do that. So I think it's understandable that though people are nervous about going back to clinical settings, the briefing we had from RNIB Scotland outlined just some of the fantastic steps clinicians are making so that it's a safe service, so that people don't need to be worried and that they can get their eyes checked. And I think the work that's been done by optometrists, which was highlighted by Emma Harper and Miles Briggs, was very important during the pandemic, but crucially going forward. So I also hope the Minister will say what response she's going to give to the request from Optometry Scotland for a fee increase this year, but also an agreement about fees being reviewed going forward so that they can plan ahead. As Miles Briggs has said, the announcement about the new eye pavilion in Edinburgh really lifted people's spirits. It was a welcomed U-turn. It took a lot of campaigning to get there. It came up at a lot of hustings before the election. But I think the other thing that really struck me was the series of articles by the Evening News in Edinburgh, which told about people's real-life experiences, how important all of our eye services are, whether it's at the community level, whether it's going to the eye pavilion, but also just the emergency experience that people had, where literally their eyes were saved in a matter of minutes. And the access to that clinical expertise and the excellence. And I know from personal experience, the very long hours staff do, the 24-hour service, even through the pandemic, that has been absolutely fantastic, and we need to thank those staff. So hopefully, let's see that we get the rapid progress on the new eye hospital. As we've said, a lot of work's been done by NHS Lothian already on the project. And I think a key thing is thinking about the community services that sit alongside that emergency treatment. Not just getting your eye checked, but making sure people follow up, making sure that any diagnosis is followed up. And I really want to thank the awareness-raising work that's been done right across the NHS and third sector organisations to make sure that we see improved eye health outcomes for people across Scotland. I think that's what this debate is all about. So I also want to urge everyone to book an eye checkup and then book another one in 2 years' time. It's not a one-off. And it's a free, accessible service, and it's vital for everybody's health and well-being. So let's get on with this. I want to thank the presiding officer for her understanding that I'll not be able to stay for the whole of this debate, but it's great to be here, and I think the energy and enthusiasm for everybody for that service really is important for us all to agree on tonight. Thank you, presiding officer.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. And I now call Colin Smith, who will be the last speaker in the open debate before the minister winds up. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Smith.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and thank you to Stuart McMillan for tabling his motion on National Health Eye Health Week. I have the pleasure of being a member of the cross-party group on visual impairment, of which Stuart is the long-standing convener, and I was pleased to see that it's going to continue to have a large active membership in this new parliamentary term after attending the AGM earlier this month. Presiding Officer, I want to take the opportunity of National Eye Health Week to say thank you to all those who look after our eye health, to our optometrists, our opticians, in fact, everyone who helps us take care of our vision. Key to that care are those eye health checks at our local optometry practice. Since Labour introduced free eye health checks in 2006, anyone in Scotland can book a checkup every 2 years at no expense, and I would strongly encourage everyone to do so, because we can have an eye condition, frankly, without knowing it. Conditions such as glaucoma and diabetic retinopathy affect the eyes before they affect the vision. Whilst the changes these conditions initially cause aren't always noticeable, they can be picked up by an optometrist and eye health check. They can then be treated before they affect sight, slowing the progression of that condition. Eye checks can also be crucial in picking up conditions before they get worse. And I want to very briefly share my own experience. Some time ago, I noticed what appeared to be a few floating objects in my eye and a little flash of light. I didn't think much of it, but I popped into my local Specsavers, though, of course, other brands are available. And I described my condition and asked for advice. I was seen straight away. I was diagnosed with a torn retina very quickly. I was referred to the hospital that day to see the on-call ophthalmologist, and the next morning they carried out the laser treatment to repair that tear. Had I not had that prompt service, that tear could easily have become very quickly a detached retina and affected my vision permanently. And as Stuart McMillan highlighted, as well as picking up conditions like this, eye checks can also detect general health conditions such as diabetes, high blood pressure and heart disease. The ability to pick up on both eye and general conditions through these checks makes eye health checks one of the most vital forms of preventative medicine. Like all health services, optometry practices have had to adapt to the pandemic to create a COVID-secure environment and minimise the risk of transmission of infection, and they have done so superbly, and their constituents can be assured it is safe to attend their local optometry practice. But despite that safe environment, it has been worrying to hear in the debate that there has been a significant reduction in the number of people choosing to attend eye health checks over the past 18 months. And as a result, fewer eye conditions will have been picked up while still at the early stages, and that means more people will have been diagnosed with more advanced eye conditions. So, Presiding Officer, we do need to keep highlighting the importance of those routine eye health checks. And if someone is diagnosed with a more advanced condition, it's vital that they do not face that diagnosis without support. Being diagnosed with an eye condition can leave people feeling shocked, saddened and scared about their future. They have worries about whether they'll retain their employment, be able to pay the bills and continue to take part in the things that they love, and that can be deeply overwhelming. But it doesn't have to be like that. We know that with proper support, people even with the most complex eye conditions can often continue in their jobs, maintain financial stability and be eligible for payments to cover the increased cost of living independently and continue to do the things that they love. A key group of people who provide support to help those do that are eye clinic liaison officers. Based on eye clinics, they discuss the impact the eye condition is having on the patient's life with them, listen to any fears or worries they have, answer questions they may not have had at the time they were given a diagnosis. They can also advise on services from rehabilitation to financial support, and also the benefits of registering as sight impaired or severely impaired. This support can be both emotional and practical, making it easier for people to get used to how they're going to live with sight loss. So, Presiding Officer, in this National Health Week, I want to thank all our ECLOs, our ophthalmologists, our optometrists who have continued to work through the pandemic to detect, treat and help people with eye conditions. In fact, every one of our health workers who have done so. And I also want to thank all those charities and groups who support for people living with visual impairments, from RNIB to Sight Scotland, for the extraordinary work they do. They really have made a difference to so many people's lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Smith. And I now call on Marie Todd Minister to wind up the debate. Up to 7 minutes, please, Ms Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I've listened with great interest to the debate this evening, and I want to add my thanks to Stuart McMillan for giving us this opportunity to mark National Eye Health Week and to discuss eye health and eye care services in Scotland. I'd also like to thank Goskirk Pettinger Optometrists, whose Dingwall practice I had the pleasure of visiting on Monday, and Sight Scotland, who I visited this morning to help launch their new national support line for visually impaired people and their families. It was a pleasure to hear my colleague Miles Briggs mention Charlie and his daughter Gail, who I met this morning. And Gail spoke so eloquently about the support that Sight Scotland gave them when Charlie first developed a visual impairment. And she talked about telephoning that helpline and it being like a warm blanket wrapped around her. So wonderful to hear such a glowing report of a service. I'm sure we can all agree that General Ophthalmic Services is one of the many NHS success stories in Scotland. I can assure members that remuneration for this service and the system for reviewing such remuneration is under active consideration, and I'm absolutely confident that we'll reach a mutually agreeable solution. The introduction in 2006 of free universal NHS-funded eye examination sets Scotland apart from the rest of the UK, and this government is committed to maintaining this policy. For the first time, everyone in Scotland, regardless of their personal situation, had access to an eye examination free of charge. A regular eye examination in Scotland provides a full health check of a patient's eyes as well as a normal sight test. And as others have said, that helps to detect early signs of sight-threatening conditions as well as other serious health conditions. Unlike the rest of the UK, patients in Scotland can also be seen by an optometrist for free as often as it is considered clinically necessary in between the regular eye examinations. And this supports the ongoing care of patients, allowing referrals to the hospital eye service to be refined and for patients to be monitored. It also allows emergency eye problems to be seen in the community and treated or appropriately referred, as Colin Smith outlined. Optometrists in Scotland are the first port of call for any eye problem, with the majority of GPs and other healthcare professionals signposting patients to their local optometrist. And that's helped to reduce the burden on GPs and hospital services. Pre-COVID, Scotland had nearly 50% fewer new hospital eye service outpatient appointments than in England. This service is enhanced by the increasing number of optometrists who've undergone further training to become independent prescribers and thus are able to issue NHS prescriptions for eye problems. Over 350 community optometrists are now fully trained independent prescribers, a quarter of the workforce in Scotland, and more than one third of all IP optometrists in the UK, and I believe we should continue to grow that number. Despite those successes, it's important that we do more to promote eye health and having a regular eye examination. The Scottish Government will continue to work with others to do this through a number of different ways. Firstly, we launched recently eyes.scot, Scotland's new national website for information about eye health and eye care services. Eyes.scot is the first website of its kind in the UK and supports public and professionals by providing easy access to information about how best to look after our eyes and vision. Secondly, we'll ensure national initiatives such as the Right Care, Right Place winter campaign continue to promote the importance of having a regular eye examination and contacting an optometrist as the first port of call for eye problems. Thirdly, We will work with the National Scottish Eye Care for Everyone, the C group, to run targeted awareness raising campaigns amongst specific patient groups where take-up of eye examinations is lower, including those living in more disadvantaged communities. The Scottish Government remains committed to ensuring that Scotland's eye care services remains world-class, and that's why we've set out ambitious but achievable plans in our NHS Recovery Plan and Programme for Government to manage more patients in the community and closer to their homes. I want to take the opportunity to briefly set out some of these in more detail. Firstly, from April 23, we will begin to roll out a national low-vision service for visually impaired people, provided in the community by accredited community optometrists and dispensing opticians. That will standardise low-vision services across Scotland, improving access and reducing waiting times, particularly in areas where the service is currently provided in hospitals. The physical and mental well-being of visually impaired people will be improved, helping to maintain their independence, reducing isolation and the need for other support services. Secondly, this year, we will pilot a new community glaucoma service. When fully rolled out, approximately 20,000 lower-risk glaucoma patients will be discharged from hospital and managed in the community by accredited IP community optometrists. Thirdly, from next summer, we will support IP optometrists to manage more anterior or front eye conditions in the community. Again, that will help to reduce the burden on GPs and on hospitals. As well as these new services, the Scottish Government will continue to provide significant investment in new digital technologies such as teleophthalmology equipment and a Once for Scotland electronic patient record to support two-way communication between community optometrists and hospital ophthalmologists. The EPR in particular is an absolute game changer that will ensure regional and national working across Scotland, ensuring that a patient's optical record is shared across the primary and secondary care interface. That will prevent duplication of effort, provide robust outcome data, ensure that ophthalmologists can provide meaningful feedback to optometrists and support more patients being managed in the community. On the Eye Pavilion, as raised by Miles Briggs, construction is due to be complete in 2026. I want to finish by putting on record this government's sincere thanks to our eye care professionals and third sector organisations. Your outstanding dedication, commitment and professionalism has ensured that patients have continued to be safely managed and supported right through the pandemic and will ensure that we continue to be able to deliver for the people in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister, and that concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.